Welcome to the conference. I can see two presenters online, and well, I have the honor to open this session, parallel session on gender and employment. So welcome everyone. We have the privilege to be on the in the start of the conference. Hopefully everyone heard Kunal Sen's housekeeping words, opening words, and well, welcome to the session. We have following rules in this session because the time is limited. We have until we have 50 minutes. 30 minutes first is for the presentations, and then 20 minutes for the questions and answers. We go in the order as is in the program. And some of the presentations are pre-recorded and some are held live. I would like to remind the audience that we are very happy to get all your comments and questions to the chat because the time is limited. So we will take them all in the end when the presentations have been heard. Do we see Aysegül Kaya Oglu in the session? No, we don't see. She is supposed to be the first one. Then maybe we can take the second presenter first, and she is Rosa Abraham. Do we have Rosa? Now, yes. Hello, welcome, Rosa.
Hi. Okay, thanks everyone for coming for this session. So today I'm going to be presenting my work with Amit Basori and Surbhi Kesar at the Center for Sustainable Employment at Azim Premji University, where we're going to look at what has been the gender impact of the pandemic on women's employment. So on March 24th, the Indian government imposed one of the most stringent national lockdowns, and the lockdown continued for nearly 2 months, despite that there were several mobility restrictions that continued afterwards. During the lockdown, as expected, because of the massive stoppage of economic activities, there were huge employment losses, with men's workforce participation falling by a third and women's almost halving. While the general understanding was that the lifting of restrictions would enable those who had lost work to return to work, we find that this is true only for men. So in this presentation, I'll describe the ways in which women's employment has been disproportionately affected as a result of the pandemic. And for this presentation, we relied largely on the panel data from the Center for Monitoring Indian Economy. The CMIE is a private data collection agency, and they've been conducting household surveys pre-pandemic, right from 2016 onwards. And because of this, we were able to construct a panel basically identifying individuals who were working pre-pandemic, trying to see what was the impact of the lockdown on their employment in the immediate month of the lockdown, as well as in the months afterwards. So using the CMIE panel, we were basically able to identify four possible employment trajectories for an individual. So someone could have lost work during the lockdown, and they could have continued to remain out of work, what we call the no recovery trajectory. They may have remained employed during the months of the lockdown, but then lost employment subsequently because of the overall economic slowdown, what we call the delayed job loss. Or someone who lost work during the lockdown may have returned to employment, what we identify as a recovery trajectory. And finally, there could have been individuals who were completely unaffected in terms of their employment status during these months, what we call the no effect trajectory. And what we find here is that women were far more vulnerable to job loss compared to men. So if you look at the yellow bar for men, about 65% of those who were in the workforce pre-pandemic were completely unaffected in terms of employment status during the lockdown and the month afterwards. In comparison, what we find is that 30% of women followed the same no-effect trajectory, nearly half that of men. In contrast, what we see is that if you look at the red part, which is the no-recovery trajectory, We find that 37% of women workers lost work and then they were not able to come back at all into employment, whereas the corresponding number for men was far less. So men who faced a no recovery trajectory was only 7%. So almost immediately we see that the pandemic has a very disproportionate impact on women's employment. And we can look at how this manifested in terms of different kinds of work. So on the left-hand side, you have these four kinds of employment arrangements that the workforce was engaged in. This is for men. So they could have been a daily wage worker, a permanent salaried worker, a temporary salaried worker, or a self-employed individual. On the right-hand side, this is the employment arrangement that they ended up in post-pandemic. So again, the four employment categories, as well as an additional out-of-workforce category. These are men who completely exited the workforce. So if you look at this, what this is saying is that in every employment category, there's about 10% who move out of the workforce. And on the other hand, there's at least 30% from every employment category who, especially in from daily wage work or salaried employment, who are moving into, say, self-employment. So for men, the transition that we see is a navigation to other kinds of work. So men had these sort of fallback arrangements in place. But what do we see in the case of women? So the same arrangements, the same categorization that we follow, if you look here on the right-hand side, the out-of-workforce category is huge in the case of women. And essentially, about from any kind of employment arrangement, be it salary permanent or temporary salaried or self-employed or daily wage work, about 50% were now moving out of the workforce entirely. And so for women, it was not that they had fallback arrangements in terms of other kinds of employment arrangements. Rather, women had to just exit the workforce altogether. And what happened for those women who remained in work, that is, they were not pushed out of the workforce, what we find then is that there is also a very gendered nature in which transition or fallback employment manifested. So here, what you can see is for men, say a daily wage worker who was employed as daily wage worker pre-pandemic, about 37% moved into self-employment. Similarly, a permanent salaried man moved about 37% moved into self-employment. So for men, the predominant fallback arrangement was really self-employment. For women, on the other hand, we see that you see a higher stickiness, which is that, you know, a daily wage worker woman remained as daily wage worker. But keep in mind, the high stickiness that you see for women is coming from the fact that many of them have just left the workforce altogether. And on the other hand, here for women, what we see is the fallback arrangement that predominated for women was daily wage work. And this is important because daily wage work is A, far more precarious, and B, far less paid than self-employment. So even for those women who remained, who were able to manage to stay in the workforce, the kind of fallback options that they had available to them was much lower. We estimated a logistic regression estimate to see how these manifested after controlling for various factors. And what we find is that women were 7 times more likely to lose jobs compared to men. And having lost jobs, women were 11 times more likely to not return to work. And so we find that this higher job loss, these odds are remaining even after controlling for differential aspects like age, religion, caste, education, and so on. And so the higher job loss and the lower likelihood of recovery cannot only be explained on the basis of women being in industries or employment arrangements that were more adversely affected because of the nature of the pandemic. Then we also looked at a stratified regression for a sample of just men and just women to see how these correlates of job loss differed for men and women. And we find that when age and experience, as well as higher education, typically shields men from job loss. So if you're slightly older and if you're higher educated, then these kind of male workers are far less likely to suffer job loss. But we do not see any such protective effect for women. Higher educated women, women with more experience, were just as likely as any other woman to lose jobs. So these shielding effects were not there for women in terms of employment loss. In terms of employment recovery too, we find very differential impacts. We find that Muslim women were actually 7 times more likely to not return to work compared to other women. We do not see such a differential effect for Muslim women. Marriage was something that held women back from returning to work. Again, married men were actually more likely to return to work. And as you would expect, women from larger households, given larger domestic responsibilities, were less likely to return. Household size had no such impact in the case of men. So to sum up, women were disproportionately affected vis-a-vis men, and gender intersects with various other aspects to exacerbate these inequities. In fact, some privileges that are associated with certain identities like age and experience and education did not extend to women. And those inequities that are associated with other aspects were actually exacerbated in the case of women. So in this context, we stress that recovery policy needs to focus on promoting women's re-entry into work. And it is particularly so because women's re-entry is likely to be crowded out because of the distress-led entry of men. And we call for the focused and targeted policies for women in the form of wage subsidies and employment guarantees that are targeted for women to bring back women into the workforce. And this is particularly important in the context of the very low female labor force participation rates that India already contends with. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This was a very interesting and wonderful presentation. Then we have to continue to the next one. And hurry and take the questions in the end. So next presenter has a video.
Good morning, one and all. I'm Dr. Priyanka Chatterjee, Assistant Professor, Sharda University, New Delhi. And I'm going to present a paper, an analysis of women's employment scenario in pre and post-COVID lockdown revival in India. This paper is co-authored by Dr. Shaini Chakraborty, Research Analyst, Institute of Social Studies Trust, New Delhi. India's ranking in Global Gender Gap Index has been falling and it has slipped by 28 places in the recent year. Women workforce participation rate is continuously and persistently falling. Unemployment rate for women in urban areas is more in the urban areas relative to both men as well as rural women. Majority of women are self-employed workers, and among the self-employed, they're mostly unpaid family helpers. Enormously informal sector workers are there among women as well as men, but the slight proportion is more for women. Agriculture is the largest employment provider for women. Apart from this, 14% are found to be engaged in labor-intensive manufacturing industries, and there has been persistent presence of gender wage gap in India even before the pandemic. In this scenario, due to this pandemic, on 24th of March 2020, there was an announcement of nationwide lockdown, which affected the entire economy very badly. And the impact of this COVID-19 pandemic has not been gender neutral, women facing the major brunt of job losses. Gender gaps in labor force participation, employment, as well as wages is expected to intensify due to this lockdown. Relative fall in employment was greater for women compared to the pre-pandemic level, and as well as the job revival has not been gender neutral. These are the three major objectives of this paper: to see the magnitude and extent of job losses and its revival across gender as overall as well as at the state level, and to evaluate this impact of lockdown and post-lockdown, apart from gender, also on industries, caste, age group, and education in India. Two major data sources are used: Consumer Pyramid Household Survey and the official surveys of India, that is a national sample survey, and the recently published periodic labor force survey data. Though these two data are not directly comparable, but they have echoed similar kinds of results. 17 major states have been considered. These are the list of the states, and they have been categorized into three categories on the basis of the confirmed COVID cases. Overall, LFPR and WPR has fallen. Absolute employment for both men and women has also fallen. Unemployment rate has increased for both men and women, men by 47 million, women by 2 million. Decline in WPR is more in the urban areas as compared to the rural areas. The immediate closure of the economy led to the fall in employment in the construction sector by 47 million because of the huge employment of the daily wage laborers. In 17 million workers lost job in manufacturing sector because of the operation of the small and micro enterprises, and 34 million workers lost job in service sector because of the informal sector, mainly because of the informal workers. Increase in unemployment rate was found across all the age groups, and it was highest for the 30 to 34 years age group. Lower caste people faces major loss of employment as compared to higher caste people, upper caste people, and employment has increased for the not literate group as compared to the other educated group. For the state-wise analysis, two time points are Jan-April 2019 and Jan-April 2020. WPR has fallen for men as well as for women for almost all the states, except for women. It has two states, Delhi and Haryana, but it's a marginal increase, so we have ignored it. Across the 17 states, 10 states, in 10 states, women experienced larger decline as compared to men, and the highest fall in women WPR was found in this following states. And this is majorly because of their pre-existing employment conditions than only the pandemic itself. Now, in the post-lockdown period, the absolute employment has declined by 1.5 million, and it is solely because of the decline in women employment by 6 million, whereas there is a revival of men employment by 4.7 million. Unemployment increased for women by 17%, which is much, much more than that of men. Number of workers has increased majorly in the construction sector as compared to the other two sectors. Upper caste experienced decline in employment, whereas the lower caste has experienced increase in employment. Recovery of youth employment is really less, and employment increased for educated people but declined for the not literate. For the state-wise analysis on the post-lockdown period, these are the two time points, May, August 2020 and January 2021. Overall, WPR has increased in all majority of the states. For men, WPR has increased in all the states. In contrast, for women, it has declined for 8 states, and Maharashtra is the highest among them. Thus, the decline in the overall WPR or less increase in the overall WPR in some of the states is because of this decline in women WPR. And hence, we can clearly say that the revival has not been generated. So compare the pre-lockdown and the post-lockdown period. The two time points are April 2019 and April 2021. WPR has declined overall. Decline in men workers is less than that of the women workers. Overall decline in the manufacturing and service sector, and slight increase in construction and agricultural sector. Upper caste workers has declined, but that of lower caste workers has increased. Youth population overall experienced decline, and most decline was for the not literate and low educated people. These two quarters, in the same phase, two quarters are taken for the statewide analysis. Overall decline in WPR in almost all the states, and highest decline was in Delhi, Tamil Nadu, and Himachal Pradesh. Decline in all the states for main WPR except in Orissa, but the decline is, but the increase is negligible. Decline in women WPR in on most of the states except Karnataka and Rajasthan. And out of the 17 major states, 12 states experienced more, 12 states experienced decline in women WPR more than that of men, again Delhi being the highest in this. These are the major conclusions: that LFPR, WPR has fallen and increased in unemployment rate during the lockdown period, and the magnitude of decline is more for women. Major affected areas are manufacturing, construction and services sector. Across states also, the impact of lockdown has been more on more for women. And the recovery was there, but the rate of recovery is less for women. And even during the after the revival, there has been revival, but the employment scenario is yet to get back to the pre-pandemic level. Some of the policy recommendations: government should provide some basic public services to reduce underpaid women work. Government should also introduce some employment guarantee program for the urban informal poor. Need of universalization of the PDS to all the poor households, and to boost up employment in the small and micro enterprises. More importantly, women run micro enterprises should get fiscal incentives, and gender sensitive infrastructure facilities should be provided at workplaces, and easy availability of public transport for the workers. Thank you very much for your attention, and we will be glad to get your feedback. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. This was very, very interesting and a wonderful presentation. Next is then, according to the program, Malvia Cinta Kindi. Do we have a pre-recorded presentation? No. So, yes, welcome. The floor is yours. You have about 6 to 7 minutes because the first presenter we haven't contacted, and everyone else also took 7 minutes. So it can take 7 minutes. Thank you.
So
Sanjali, thank you everybody for being here today and for this wonderful session. I would like to initially begin by thanking for the Center for the Study of Women in the Society at the University of Oregon for funding this research. And I'm very grateful to be presenting amongst all the experts and scholars here today. To essentially begin my presentation, I would like to start with discussing the work of Shannon Speed, an acclaimed anthropologist, from her book on incarcerated stories. In this particular book, she speaks about how indigenous women face multiple vulnerabilities that render them more vulnerable, the circumstances around them, rather than the conditions that they are individually experiencing. This illustration was particularly developed for my primary research that has been undertaken over a span of 18 months. Women from low income and more poorer economic, socioeconomic backgrounds and belonging to backward caste communities in a few sections of the metropolitan city of Hyderabad, located in south of India, were my primary research participants. Their poor economic status, their more poorer social class, which is obviously the backward caste they belong to, their historical oppression render them multiply vulnerable to several issues that they face at the household and outside their household level. They're all primarily migrants coming from different parts of the country. They are moving to the city essentially for their temporary jobs or permanent jobs, either with their husbands working as watchmen or drivers or contract laborers, with women primarily being domestic help, because that's the major choice of major choice of jobs for these women who are essentially migrants. They face heavy gender-based discrimination because, as also understood, the informal labor market is also very gender discriminatory in nature. Women are more in the sense of precarious jobs as compared to their male counterparts, with them earning way lesser than the males. And essentially, even if it's the same kind of job, they earn lesser than their male counterparts. Here you see the lady in the pink, as I like to call this illustration. She takes care of her ailing in-law, her very alcoholic husband, her two very small children. She takes care of the household chores. She lives in this very congested slum area with a thatched roof. And this ethnographic inquiry has allowed me to illustrate and understand their lived experience to as much extent as possible, given COVID-19 restrictions and a lot of learning experiences by conducting this primary research by myself over a span of these 18 months. The chosen locality for this research is Baglingampally. Baglingampally is understood to be a district in Hyderabad city as per the Indian Administrative Unit, but there are many slums within this district. Palamuru Basti is the slum I've chosen. There are many reasons for this particular choice of the Basti. It is larger. It has around 420 households. There are several levels of households conducted in this region. There are people belonging to several religious groups, several castes, and several ethnic minority groups that live in this particular Basti. A pilot study was conducted in a very similar region like this Basti, but Baglingampally was chosen for its historic significance. Bag means garden in Hindi, and Lingampally was the area where there were wells built for queens to bathe during the pre-colonial times. So this region reflects pre- and post-colonial textures in this particular community. 30 participants were chosen essentially because this was an applied ethnographic study, and over from September 2020 to July 2021, these participants were observed. Semi-structured interviews, in-depth interviews, and participant observation were undertaken, along with looking at all sorts of literature review and quantitative data that is floating all around ever since the pandemic has offered a window of opportunity to conduct this sort of research. Essentially, the research questions boil down to how COVID-19 and nation's stringent lockdown impact women belonging to backward castes, working as informal labor, if there were any coping mechanisms that they've developed, how were they dealing with stress or trauma, how has the pandemic affected the voices of the women and their agency. The approach has come from intersectionality and complexity theory. The reason for choosing these both in combination was essentially look at all primary categories without any discrimination in terms of what category or what indicator is more important than the other. The data has been inductively coded. All the qualitative interviews have been inductively coded. Hankowski's intersectionality-based analysis framework has been used to look and understand the themes emerging and the sections emerging from the data. This particular intersectionality-based analysis framework has been used in several health and public policy related challenges, and it has been a well-developed concept even in anthropology, and hence this interdisciplinarity as a view has allowed me to be more flexible in terms of bringing out indicators that were majorly even not a prime focus of these research questions itself. as understood and as very, very predicted, income has been majorly hurt due to the pandemic. You see the maroon bars that indicate a loss in family income. The blue bars indicate a very isolated increase in family income. Females in general, as we've discussed earlier, earn lesser than males. Males are experiencing more loss than females during the pandemic. Some males have even lost their jobs in entirety, contributing to loss in family income. Essentially, females' jobs have been acting as a safety net, sort of offsetting the family's income losses, essentially increasing their agency and in terms their importance, even though they don't face the privileges of feeling equal at household level or the outside. There have been scattered benefits reported by all the research participants. The figure that you see on help from employers, 46%, the help essentially quantifies to advice, friendly advice, suggestions, or COVID-19 related benefits and information. There are very few corporates and civil societies within this region, because that has been a very well discussed topic, essentially in Hyderabad, because Hyderabad as a city is known to be consistently spending the topmost in the country for people belonging to backward caste communities. And there have been very far and few NGOs that have, or corporate and civil societies that have helped these particular regions. Government ration, the lentils and all sort of grain and monetary compensation that are offered to backward caste communities has only been during the initial times of the pandemic, not throughout. Vaccine concerns, this was a very important, very interesting finding. 73% of the participants reported trust in vaccine, whereas only 50% of them took the vaccine. They understand COVID to be a communicable disease. In the local language, it's antuvyadi, meaning it is communicable in nature. They have extreme distrust on the vaccine itself. Most of them have taken the vaccine because it's a government or an employer's mandate than their own understanding of the health benefits of the vaccine. Obviously, coupled with vaccine inequities and lack of stock, as also discussed by previous presenters right now. Domestic violence. 30% of the participants discussed about domestic violence in its intensity. It is understood that COVID-19 has facilitated domestic violence. There is a lot of research around how domestic violence has increased during COVID-19 that was sort of difficult to decipher with this particular set of participants in this region, because they were not essentially able to differentiate between the kind and the intensity of domestic violence they faced prior to the onset of the pandemic, during and the post, like right now, the third wave or the impending third wave of COVID-19 in India. So they were not able to essentially discuss or explain the differences they felt prior and during the pandemic. And obviously, a lot of the husbands and household members are heavily alcoholic. And there is a dearth of literature around the kind of violence experienced during pandemics. The most recent literature around violence during pandemics, essentially in this sort of unprecedented times, was from the tsunami in India in 2004. That's a very interesting space to conduct more research in. The last conclusion. So,
time to wrap up. Okay.
Thanks. Just going to conclusions. Like, thank you. Sorry for going over the time. So one of my main interests and motivation to conduct this research was to understand the effects on development and equality. So a lot of definitions have been thrown around with regard to what development means to the participants, as you see as a list. And there was a major focus on financial losses and lack of familial support from the participants that they've reported to be as a lack of development for them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting content and wonderfully presented. Then we have the last presenter, Jacqueline Velasco, and I think she has a presentation.
Good morning, and thank you to WIDER for organizing this conference. The title of my presentation is Effects of COVID-19 on Women's Well-being, Evidence from the Peruvian Case. This is a joint work with Julia Velasco and Ramon Ballester. COVID-19 is not only a health crisis. The measures implemented by governments to control the spread of infection have caused severe economic crisis. This is the case of Peru, a Latin American country with high levels of informal employment, limited access to health services, and structural rural poverty. In this context, COVID-19 has exacerbated economic inequalities and deepened poverty. Given this context, the aim of this presentation is twofold: to identify changes in women's well-being with a focus on employment and use of time spent on unpaid care work, and to suggest policy interventions to reduce impact caused by the pandemic. The analytical framework. The analysis is based on the gender economics and capabilities approaches that place people's well-being at the center of development. This capability approach, when it focuses on the analysis of the link between work and well-being, identifies the dimension of time and income as mediators for the achievement of functions in the development of capabilities. In this sense, the analytical framework identifies various women's roles and different transmission channels by which the crisis is affecting the well-being and development options for women. This diagram summarizes the analytical framework proposed. Transmission channels through which confinement measures have impacted household well-being and women in particular have been classified according to the roles women assume in their relationships with family, markets, and society. Such roles are those that allow women to be considered consumers of goods and services, producers, entrepreneurs, or self-employed, dependent workers, home care providers, and citizens. The suggested effects on each of the identified roles are contingent on pre-existence conditions to COVID-19, including gender gaps in incomes, time use, and political participation, for example. Now, identification of impacts of COVID on the well-being of women, we are going to concentrate in the time use pattern. Analyzing time use patterns, a care crisis is identified in the period prior to the COVID-19. Expressing the existence of a gender gap in care. A household wealth index was estimated and composed of three indicators: quality of housing, access to public services, and durable consumer goods. Figure shows the distribution of the time dedicated to the unpaid domestic work by quintiles of the wealth index, area of residence, and sex. It is identified that in households that are in the lowest quintiles of wealth, women have a greater participation in unpaid domestic activities. These figures show the allocation of time by age groups, distinguishing between the time dedicated to the care of babies, children, and adolescents, and the time allocated to the care of household members with physical, mental difficulties, or elderly. The analysis of both figures shows an interesting pattern of substitution within the time devoted to home care activities. The care of chronically ill, elderly, and disabled household members in the final phase of the life cycle is added to the care of children in the early stages of the woman's life cycle. A telephone survey carried out in May 2020 by the Ministry of Women found that men increased their participation in household work and childcare slightly, but most of the burden fell on women, who were already doing most of this work before the lockdown. Given this situation, it could be concluded that the care crisis, which predates the pandemic, has deepened. The situation is even worse for female head household, being 28% of total household in Peru. Now, identification of impacts on the labor market participation. There are two mechanisms through which COVID-19 and the confinement measures impacted the labor market. These are employment level and conditions and labor income. Lockdown measures drastically reduce employment opportunity for men and women. The impact on the labor market is expressed in an increase in unemployment, informality, with women having the highest participation rate and underemployment. Added to this is a drop in labor income. And now finally, focus on policy action to reverse the effect of COVID on the well-being of women. Policy measures to contain COVID-19 are not gender neutral. Our analysis suggests some policy implications. The first policy action is related to the need to develop a comprehensive national care system with mechanisms that promote joint responsibility for care among families, markets, civil society, and the state, and reduce the burden of care on women. This will enhance economic growth by improving maternal labor force participation, reducing the care cost burden on families. Furthermore, care policy could be adjusted to life cycle, considering the needs of children, disabled, chronically ill, and the elderly. The current Peruvian care system is family-based, and it is recommended that it be changed to one system with higher participation of market, state, and civil society. This new approach should recognize care as a human right and integrate it with public policy. The second policy action refers to the design of mechanisms that support women participation in formal labor through active labor policies, such as subsidies to the payroll, tax reduction, gender quota, and so on. Finally, if the increase in informal labor is due to a survival strategy, it is crucial that the social protection policy provides income transfer to the most vulnerable workers. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. So now it is time for questions and answers. If you are in the session tab, you can click on the Q&A tab and write your questions there. I think we have 70 people viewing this session, so perhaps there are some questions coming soon there.
So there's a question from Nikita in the Q&A. So I can take that, and maybe if there are others questions for others, they can go ahead and take those. So I'll just read out the question. So it says, given selection into different occupation types by gender, should you not control for the pre-pandemic occupations to analyze if the pandemic had a different gender differentiated effect? Yeah, I think this is a great point. So what we did actually in the logistic regression estimates was that both in the overall estimates as well as in the stratified samples, we did control for the pre-pandemic occupation. So we controlled for this in two ways. One is we controlled for the pre-pandemic employment status, which is that employment type rather, which is whether they were in daily wage work or salaried work or any other kinds of employment. And we also controlled for the industry of employment. So were they in health, modern professional services or non-professional services? So what we find just specific to these kind of controls is that, so in terms of salaried work, both men and women are less precarious to employment loss compared to the other kinds of occupations. But the other interesting fact that emerged is that even when women are in daily wage work, they are far more susceptible to employment loss compared to a man in daily wage work. And the other thing that we saw also was that, you know, for men, there's these, for things like daily wage work and self-employment, which are these informal activities, there's a characteristic which of this activity where there's high ease of exit as well as high ease of entry. So they are very likely to lose jobs, but then they also come back into work because of the flexible nature of these kind of work patterns. We see that for men, but we don't see this for women. So this is sort of, even if they were daily wage worker to begin with and they came back, they were less likely to come back if it was a woman. So we did control for that. And in terms of industry too, we controlled for these kinds of industry or pre-pandemic industries. And here too, we find that, say, women in health and education are far more likely to lose jobs compared to women in other sectors. So yeah, just I hope that answers the question. I don't know, Mila, if your audio is working now.
I think now it's working. I refreshed the page and now I think it works better.
Okay.
If you have problems, this could help also for others. So you could read my question there, but then, so yeah, I'm not sure if you answered that, but So
I can quickly answer that. So yeah, we do see a difference by the income of the household, pre-pandemic income. So like you said, that richer people are less likely to lose jobs because there's also that their jobs are or such that they can kind of stay at home and work, and they are also more secure jobs. And we see that the employment loss is far more higher amongst the poorer households. But the employment recovery is also actually better amongst the poorer households, because these are households that are engaged in very flexible labor markets. So there's an ease of re-entry. So if you're in a higher income household and you lose jobs, then your likelihood of coming back into work is actually less because you're in a slightly more formal employment arrangement.
Thank you. Then there's another question. What I would like to ask from Malvia about the domestic violence. Not sure if you found from your interviews, but domestic violence increased. Could it be due to larger presence at home? Due to more problems with income, accruing income, or which could be the main reason for this, and in which kind of households this could appear most, if you have this sort of findings.
Thank you, Mila. So one of the most difficult questions and discussions were around domestic violence, because women in general reported domestic violence as an ongoing daily activity in their household. So essentially, it was not just any change due to the pandemic, but one major change that has occurred in their daily lives due to the pandemic is the self-imposed lockdown and restrictions by the local governments. And because of that, they felt suffocated. That is something that they were able to express, because obviously they could not socialize enough. There was no way out to vent. And also it's important to note that though they are all informal laborers and belonging to very lower socioeconomic classes, they share some level of camaraderie and friendship with their employers. They lose that sort of a connection when they're all stuck in the household. So number one, they're suffocated. But the other thing is that the males who have been employed in sort of better, well-paying and little more physically intensive jobs, such as construction laborers and so on and so forth, are all at home. They're frustrated. And obviously the frustration is directly shown on the women. I'm not saying all the participants and all the 420 households in the Basti, in the slum area were this way, but major, the 30 participants who were consenting, who were willing to go on record, who were willing to like sort of discuss these things, have said so, that it is because of alcohol, number one. Number two, it's also because of withdrawal from alcohol, because at a point when all the shops were closed, males were all stuck at home. That's number two. And number three, because of lack of income, there are a lot of things that they were not able to do for the household, such as paying bare minimum bills, such as electricity. And the frustration is again shown on the woman. So she becomes sort of a vehicle to take all of these things in, because when things go wrong, the immediate effect is shown on the second class citizen of the household, which is the woman. And this was, yeah, these were their words, not mine.
Thank you. Do we have any time left, Elina? What is the situation? I think it looks like we have no time left, but I think it is 11 o'clock. And it seems like it is time to go to the main session. I would like to thank you all for great presentations, and I would like to continue this discussion. I would have questions to Priyanka as well, but unfortunately the time is very short, and I hope that people are able to contact each other and continue this discussion. Perhaps you also presenters can find each other and you have great insights to share and discuss. But without further ado, I think we will have to go to the main hall to listen to the opening keynote speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.